friends and fellow bridge builders. Namaskars to every one of you. We are met together on a sacred day. Today is sacred to the memory of Guru Tegh Bahadur. He was the ninth Sikh Guru. So many of us regard him as a prince amongst martyrs. He was one of the noblest of men. He was so simple, so gentle, so kind, so full of the spirit of humility and helpfulness. And though he was filled with the spirit of courage, he never hurt anyone. He never did anything which may harm anyone. I bow down to him. I seek his blessings on all of us and on this evening's meeting. Today, as has been told you, we are met together at a question-answer session. And as I have repeatedly said to you on similar occasions in the past, questions can be asked by anyone. Likewise, answers too can be given by anyone. For surely, there will be some questions to which I may not be able to give adequate answers. If at any time you find that you have a better answer to a question than the one I have given, kindly don't hesitate in asking for the mic. Nothing will make me happier than to leave this hall having been enlightened by your knowledge, by your wisdom, by your experience. If you like, if you permit, we will start the question.
Dada, when I am unable to make a decision, I leave it to God. But I am unable to see or understand signs of God. Please guide me on how to interpret God's will.
When you are unable to solve a problem, the best thing is that you should enter into silence and place the problem at the lotus feet of the Lord or at the lotus feet of your Guru. After that, you forget the problem. Somehow or the other, you will get an answer. In some way or the other, you will get the answer. Maybe you will open a book and you will read a line which answers your question. Or maybe that night you may have a dream. In the dream you may get an answer. But this is very essential. Practice silence. Place the problem at the lotus feet of the Lord or at the lotus feet of your Guru. Then forget the problem. You will get the answer. A little practice will strengthen this procedure. Yes.
Pranam, Dada.
Pranams.
Dear Dada, why is it easier to get attracted to the world than to you, even after knowing which is the obvious better choice?
Even?
After knowing which is obviously the better choice, to be attracted to you. How do
you... Don't be attracted to me, where will I be if you get attracted to me? Get attracted to my Guru, Gurudev Sadhu Vaswani. The reason is this, that through a series of lives that we have lived in the past, we have been attached to the sights and shows of this phenomenal world through a long series. Birth after birth, we have been attached to the sights and shows, the passing shows of this ephemeral existence. It is difficult to put off that, to work against that power of attraction in a moment's time, or in a day's time, or in a week's time. It takes time. You have to explain to your mind. Your mind should understand and cooperate with you. The mind should understand that all these things after which I am running, all these things which attract me, are no better than shadows. They come and go. Nothing abides. So, through this process of explaining to the mind, almost every day, the day comes when the mind understands and the mind cooperates with you. And then it is a march towards God.
Thank you, Dada.
Dada, I have been ill-treated and tortured by my husband and in-laws. How do I tackle this situation? Should I put up with the torture, accepting it as a part of my karma? Or should I take a divorce? But would taking a divorce mean that I am running away from my karma?
I would not advise you to take a divorce. You have been You have become a member of this family on account of your karma. You have to pay off your karma. If you get a divorce, you will have to pay this karma with interest in a future life. So the sooner you pay off, the better. But you pray for them. Prayer has power. You pray for them. You should not have any ill feelings in your mind or heart for these relatives of yours, father-in-law, mother-in-law, others who have ill-treated you. But it's all due to karma, yes. You should come for consolation, for solace to the satsang. Satsang will give you the comfort that you are searching for. You should read the lives of saints. They will comfort your agitated mind. Go out and serve some poor people, some handicapped children. That will give you strength.
Dear Dada, is matching horoscopes important for marriage? And nowadays pundits say that if some aspects of the horoscope do not match, then you can do a puja to remedy that situation. Should we believe them?
If the pandit is trustworthy, you should believe him. But there are so many pandits who have become commercial in their attitude. Whenever you go to them, they pasau you. And they tell you, you must do puja, otherwise this calamity will befall you, this misfortune will come your way. But if you know that the pandit is honest, there is some truth in pujas, yes, provided the pandit is an honest man. It is better to get the thing confirmed by consulting more than one pandit. Whenever a surgeon asks a patient to undergo a surgery and he comes to me for advice, I tell him, get a second opinion. If two opinions agree, then you go in for a surgery. Likewise here too, take a second opinion. Ask another Pandit without telling him what the first Pandit told you.
Dada, is it correct to be non-judgmental all the time?
You can be judgmental if it concerns you, not others. Judge not, lest you may be judged. If you judge others, you will be judged by others. Do not judge others, but you can judge yourself. That is the way to self-improvement. I often suggest to my friends that every day they should spend at least 15 minutes sitting in a silence corner, going over all the things that have happened during the previous 24 hours. You will always find that there are acts of commission and omission, things which you should have done but did not do, things which you should have done, things which you should not have done but you did. Then ask for strength and wisdom. Pray for strength and wisdom from God not to repeat those mistakes in future. This should be done every day. But this is judging oneself. You should not judge others, no.
You just now spoke of karmas. You spoke just now pertaining to karma.
Yes.
Dada, can God not interfere in the law of karma?
He can.
And is Sankirtan also a way which can cut karmas?
Sankirtan will give you strength to face the karma in the right spirit. We need strength. Karma comes for our good. Karma is not punitive. Karma does not want to punish it. Karma loves us, and karma wants us to become better, nobler, superior than what we are at the moment. So karma is not punitive. Karma is reformative. Once you understand this, your problem, I think, will be solved. But Sankirtan will give you strength to face your karma in the right spirit. Sankirtan will lift you to a higher level. Their karma cannot touch you. Whatever be your karma, you won't mind at all. Sankirtan, you are absorbed in the holy name of God. Nothing will affect you.
Dada, I always feel like talking to you, but the moment you stand in front of me, I get tongue-tied. At the same time, I see others talking to you so very freely. Dada, can you please bless me so that I too can open my heart and talk to you easily?
No, you open your heart to me again and again. Because you already have talked to me freely, you don't talk to me when you are in front of me. So, that is always better. That's always better. You have followed a better path.
Dear Dada, how does a young person in their 20s try and get out of a problem, both financial and physical?
Both?
Financial and physical. And break the habit of getting lured by negative things like illegal money and attraction towards the opposite sex.
If you will try to fight these two forces, lure of money and attraction to the opposite sex, face to face, you will not be able to succeed. But you should lift up your consciousness to a higher level. A level at which neither the lure of money nor the attraction to the opposite sex affects you. That you can do by moving in the right company, by doing sankirtan, by doing selfless service, by studying the biographies of saints and holy men, by always being positive in your attitude. Then you go to a higher level where the lure of money or will not affect you, will not touch you at all. Now you are stuck in these two great temptations. Sri Ramakrishna Paramahansa used to call them Kanchan and Kamini. Kanchan is lure of money and Kamini is attraction to the opposite sex. You go to a higher level where these two do not reach you. But you have to be very careful about the company you keep, about the books you read, about the scenes that you witness on the TV screen. You have to be very careful. You have to be awake all the time. Yes. You don't have to let an impure thought enter your mind. The moment an impure thought enters your mind, give yourself a slap. It will go away. Or pinch yourself. Or take up a pin and pierce it in your flesh. But you have to do something.
Dada, when one disciple gets to do the seva of his Gurudev, he does not like the other person to do that seva. Is this attitude of this disciple correct?
No. It is the ego that does not want. The correct attitude should be, let the Guru's will be done. Whatever the Guru wishes. I wish, I will, whatever the Guru wills. That is the correct attitude. You should rejoice. Now, for instance, I have passed through these experiences. Gurudev Sadhu Vaswani always, every day, used to ask me to press his legs. Then either to test me or perhaps sometimes he was displeased in me, I do not know. But there were occasions when he would not even look at me. He would ask somebody else to come and press his legs. Then I used to go and press the legs of that person who was pressing the legs of Sadhu Vaswani. This way it will reach it. And gradually I felt very happy if some service to which I was called regularly was taken away from me. I felt happy because that is the Guru's wish. And I can always serve that person who has been asked now to serve the Guru. I know what it means when the service which you are doing is taken away from you. The first reaction is a terrible experience. I've gone through it. But I found that this was a very good method of facing that experience.
Good evening, Dada.
Good evening to you.
I would start with a really simple question. How do you differentiate between good and bad? It might seem a really simple question, but for me it has been the most difficult thing to define till now.
Until you are sure whether a thing is good or bad, it will be better if you refer the matter to a spiritual elder. He will guide you. Don't depend on yourself.
I tried to find the answers through many books or anything, but it's like somebody has very rightly said, okay, nothing is good or bad in this world. It's the human mind which makes it so. So if you go at the starting of the human life, if you ask to a baby okay, whether this is good or this is bad, he won't be able to define anything. But just if you pinch him to physicality or if you hurt his body, so that would be really something which is bad for that baby children. So if a person, to go in examples, if a person drinks or if a person does not drink, so if good does not exist, then how can we define what is bad? And if bad does not exist, then how can we define good? And accordingly, our parents teach us to be good to poor, be charitable. So that becomes really mechanical. I mean, I feel good because my parents have told me to donate. So when I donate, it comes from inside, I have done a good thing. But somehow, people do it from their heart. I mean, if somebody had told them, they're working pretty mechanically. So for everything, my answer does not... I don't find answer to anything because everything goes in confusion. This is good or this is bad, and I'm not able to define people. Even if a person do bad for me, I'm not able to define that he has done bad, because that helps me somewhere. Because if he has done bad, good, bad, it helps me somewhere.
If anybody does bad to you, good will be done to you, because that is the law of life. Out of evil cometh good, but woe unto the doer of evil. The doer of evil is not doing the right type of karma. And secondly, you must remember that you are not a baby any longer. Your intelligence, your buddhi, your intellect has grown. And you must make use of your intellect. And if in spite of that, you are unable to decide finally what is good, what is bad, you must go to a spiritual elder and place your difficulty before him. But then obey him, follow him, you will be blessed. Until such time as you are able to decide for yourself what is good and what is bad. Yes.
Dada?
Yes?
What should be the youth's contribution to the world to make it a better and a happier place to live in?
What should be?
The contribution of the youth.
The youth first need to be simple. The youth are running after pleasure today. Pleasure draws them more than the good. In the Upanishads, the Rishi speaks of two paths. The choice is given to us at every step, in every round of life. Either to walk the way of the pleasant. Sex draws so many because it is the pleasant. But it takes you to your doom. It takes you into a hellish world. Purity is the path of, the first is the path of prayer, the path of the pleasant prayer, not prayer, but prayer. Prayer means the pleasant. Then there is the other path, the path of Shreya. It leads to our good. It is a rugged path, it is a rough path, it is a path strewn with thorns, perhaps with flames, but it takes us to our good, ultimate good. You are asked to choose Shreya. Whenever you feel you are moving on the path of prayer, take a stick in your hand and beat yourself. It's worth it. I must move on the path of Shreya. never on the path of prayer. Once you give in and walk on the path of prayer, you have been imprisoned by Satan. There is no hope in you. Be very careful. Be aware all the time. In the Nuri Granth, there is a song, the refrain of which is Uth Jag Chaukidar. Uth Jag Chaukidar. You have to be a watchman. You have to watch over yourself. Every thought that you get, every word that you utter, every action that you perform. That is the true art of living.
Dear Dada, what is the real purpose of life and how can we achieve that purpose?
Each one gets an answer to this question in his own way. As you enter into the depths of silence within, a stage comes when you hear a voice, and the voice tells you what is the purpose of your life. Because there are really two purposes. There is a general purpose, there is a specific purpose. There is a purpose which only you can fulfill. Nobody else can do it. 6 billion people, 6 billion purposes, which only you can fulfill. No one can do it for you. But there is a general purpose, and that purpose is to grow in perfection. Grow in perfection from more to more. But don't try to be more perfect than others. Try to be more perfect than what you were yesterday. Today you should be more perfect. Tomorrow you should be more perfect than you are today. Don't compare yourself with others. Always think of yourself as the lowest. But keep on becoming better and better and better.
Dada, you have spoken about 3 journeys every soul must take. Recently, you have mentioned 2 journeys. First, journey away from God. The second, journey back to God. Please tell us which is the 3rd journey.
There is the 3rd journey. It is a long journey. It is a seemingly endless journey. It is the journey in God. Journey away from God. Journey back to God. When you reach God, when you arrive at the point where you become one with God, you enter into the 3rd journey. It is the journey in God. It is a journey in which many experiences unfold. It is an endless journey.
Dear Dada, somebody asks, what will happen in 2012? Will the world end?
And the world will not end, but maybe I will end before that. The world will not end. No. They have been predicting the end of the world since centuries. While we were in the 20th century, they gave us many dates. They said the world is going to be is going to end in 1918. Then they came when 1918 was over, the world did not end. They said the world will end in 1928. 1928 also the world survived. Then they said the world will end in 1956, and so on. So they keep on. But quite a number of people are focusing now on 2012, yes. But you will pass through it, many of you. So don't worry, don't be anxious. And if the world ends, what then? What then? You won't end. You have the gift of life which is endless. You don't die, you don't end. It is the body, it is the material self within you that ends. You don't die, you are immortal. Weapons cannot cleave you, and fires cannot burn you, and waters cannot drench you, and the winds cannot dry you away. Those are the words of the Gita. Those are the words of the Lord Sri Krishna as he gives, unfolds his doctrine of the spiritual life in the Bhagavad Gita.
Dada, why don't we face the consequences of bad karmas in that birth itself? Why does it have to be followed in the next birth?
Because in the eyes of God, there is no this birth and next birth. In the eyes of God, life is one continuous thing. Life is like a flowing river. It keeps on flowing, flowing. So, according to the view which belongs to God, there are no two lives, this life and that life. There is no past, there is no present. There is only now, now. Therefore, the holy ones, the saints and the satpurkhas of humanity ask us to live in the now. Now is the only time that exists. But we are, most of us, we are either worrying about the past or we are afraid of the future. And so we don't get the joy of the moment, the joy of now. Now is the time. To God there is no present, to God there is no past, there is no future.
Dear Dada, it is said that we should forgive the person who has wronged us. But sometimes it is so deep that we can't forgive. So at such times, how do we forgive that person?
There was a man who came to his guru. And this man said to him, that this particular individual has troubled me a number of times. He has troubled me 10 times, and now it is the 11th time, 10 times I have forgiven him. It is the 11th time that he has started troubling me. What shall I do? I cannot forgive him anymore. Then the guru said to him, what if God were to say the same to you? You have committed the same mistake 100 times, 200 times, 300 times. God has forgiven you every time. If God were to tell you, I will not forgive you any longer, what will be your condition? Forgiveness should not be counted. The number of times that you forgive should not be counted. Because God never counts. We should always give a chance to the man to improve. Because there is divinity within everyone. Every one of us carries the divine spark within us. I had on an earlier occasion given you the example of Tolo. Tolo was the son of a rich man, a wealthy zamindar. Tolo's father passed away, leaving all his wealth to Tolo. This happened in Hyderabad, Sindh, when we were in Pakistan. Tolo got all that wealth, but Tolo was given to the habit, evil habit of gambling. Within a very short time, he gambled away his entire property. It was a huge property, but he gambled away. He gambled away even his own house, the house in which he lived. Now he had no house to live. So he just used to lie down in the street. He gambled away his clothes, whatever he had. This gambling too is a sort of, it's a disease or whatever it is. It's like scratching. You keep on scratching all the time. So this man, he lost everything that he had. One night he was sleeping on the street when a man happened to pass by. The man looked at him and said to him, "Aren't you Tolo, the son of so-and-so, this rich man?" Tolo said, "Yes, sir, I am Tolo." "What has happened to you? Why are you sleeping on the street and in this wintry cold when your body should be shivering? Why don't you go to your house?" He said, "Sir, but I have no house. I have gambled away all the wealth which was left me by my father, and this is my condition." Immediately this man got him a quilt, because the cold was very intense. We have winters which are very cold in Hyderabad, at least in those days. That is how it used to happen. So he got him a quilt, and this quilt Tolo used for only 2 or 3 days. On the fourth day again there was the scratching, and he lost the quilt in his gamble. After 4 or 5 days, the rich man, friend of his father, again happened to pass by and found this man lying on the roadside without a cover. He asked him, "Tolo, what has happened?" Tolo, with his head hanging low, said, "What could I do? I could not resist the temptation of gambling. I thought I'll get all my wealth back, and I lost the quilt." So this wealthy man got him a second quilt. This was repeated how many times? Third time, fourth time, fifth time, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth, tenth, 11th, 12 quilts this wealthy man got for him. He was not tired. He had every hope that Tolo would improve. But the 12th quilt was also lost in gambling. Then this man got him the 13th. 13 in our language is Tera. Tera. And this man offered a prayer. He said, "Lord, everything is Tera. Tolo is also Tera. The quilt is also Tera. You must do something for him." That woke up the conscience of Tolo. He said, "What am I doing? I'm wasting my life in gambling and losing everything." That was the turning point. The journey away from God, the journey back to God. And Tolo became a new man. But for 12 times, the wealthy man, the friend of his father, forgave him. So there should be no limit to our forgiveness.
Dada, can we have one last question, please?
Yes.
Dear Dada, does service towards your elderly mother take priority over serving the Guru?
I am not...
Does service towards your elderly mother take priority over...
No.
Serving the Guru?
Yes. Service to the old mother takes priority, because the Guru has many to serve him, whereas your old mother has only you. You are the only one who can serve her. Nobody else will come to her aid. And you can always explain to the Guru that your old mother needs you. "Gurudev, will you permit me to to go and serve my old mother. The Guru will be very happy because he has many to serve him. So many are waiting in a queue to serve the Guru. But the old mother, if you don't serve him, there was another Tolo I'm reminded of. His name was also Tolo. Tolo was himself quite a wealthy man. He had an old grandmother. The old grandmother was sick, and he used to attend to her needs. She could not bear the touch of anyone other than Tolo. One day, this also happened in Hyderabad, Sen. One day, Sarojini Naidu, maybe you have heard her name. In her time she was very famous. She was known as the Nightingale of India, Sarojini Naidu. She happened to visit Hyderabad. And there was an announcement made that we want volunteers to wait in attendance upon Sarojini Naidu. Tolo gave his name. He said, I will become a volunteer. Then Tolo's guru explained to him, told him, your grandmother has only one person to serve her. Sarojini Naidu will get 100. You should be true to your duty. So duty to the mother, old mother, I think, takes priority. Shall we close? Or if there's any other question?
Thank you, Dada. Thank you so much, Dada, for the most enlightening question and answer session. I'm sure when we walked into this hall, our minds were filled with numerous questions and doubts. But now when we will walk out with the perfect explanations and impeccable solution. Really, Dada, where would we be without you?